And so, the secrets of the monastery remained there, hidden in wait until their time. The tide finally seemed to turn in favor of the Empire. Once the gathering's hold over the Exarchy was shattered, a devastating attack by the combined Imperial forces brought the fighting in that theater of war to a close. Once the last rebel stronghold in Garat was destroyed, the world would find its peaceful ways once more. Father Anastasius found he could not burden the difficulty of isolation any longer, not after the journey he had been through. Though Tiris did offer him a role in the Thrax's court, he humbly turned it down to become a priest for one of the little villages dotting the mountains of Thracia. Admiral Stefan was proud to be a part of the expedition, but the scar of disaster he had caused at Vlora could not be healed so easily. Retirement suited him better, and indeed, after he congratulated everyone for their work, he left for his hometown in Odrysia. I have heard that many tried to talk with him, to learn about the war and so on. But he did not wish to remember those days, even in his last moments. Sven, the mercenary working for the Wharfmasters, went east shortly after the expedition was over. Sometimes rumors about his exploits with the strange people that inhabit that area creep their way through the long merchant routes all the way back here. But those are just rumors. Even so, he would not be remembered for long after his time. Capital Alexander was not keen on abandoning his nomadic way of life. Once the war was over, he went back to his clansmen and took up piracy once more. I have heard of a story in which he fights Tiris in single combat, in one of his many convoy raids. But the sources on this are not as reliable. A bright future awaited Anton after the expedition. Who would have thought that the humble lieutenant, hailing from an impoverished peasant family, would one day become one of the leading military strategists in the whole world? Awards after decorations, honors after medals. By the time he reached 50 years of age, his uniform could no longer contain them all. And even though he technically did outrank Tiris, he never stopped calling him his effendi. The Grand Master of the Seneschals was relieved to have accomplished Sayadi's bidding. If it was not for the fact that he was recalled back not a moment after the city was taken, we could say he slept peacefully from then on. He returned to the Imperial Academy to become its headmaster, so that he could spread his knowledge onto the next generation of Tarkans. I believe he yet lives. It is not known how Bastakos initially fell out of the court's favor, but in supporting Tiris, he did regain his lost stature. He was employed by Sayadi for much of his life, and is now remembered in the history books as an important character to the development of the new Imperial Legal Code. One should not be surprised to learn that the old voivod's time was almost over. Indeed, for after 3 days of rest in the city, he was found peacefully resting below the shade of an old olive tree. He was buried in the entrance of the ancient monastery in remembrance to the fulfillment of his oath. One can still go there and see for himself. As for our prince, he chose to live a simple life, away from the splendor and glamour of the royal courts. His last years were spent in isolation, living in a small cottage near the place he held dearest to his heart. And that is all about these people. This story is now over. But comes change, comes crisis, and the cruelness of the world. So comes the need. And when those times come, so shall our children, or their children once more, take flight to Hara Vera.